Avijja paccaya sankhara, sankhara paccaya vijnana, vijnana paccaya nama rupa, nama rupa paccaya sarayatana, sarayatana paccaya pasa, pasa paccaya vedana, vedana paccaya tanna, tanna paccaya upadana, upadana paccaya bhava, bhava paccaya jati, jati paccaya jaramaranam, soka prateva dukkha domana supayasa sambhavanti, Ema metasa kevalasa dukkha kandasa samudayo hoti Avijayate vasesa viraga niroda samkara niroda Samkara niroda vijnana niroda Vijnana niroda nama rupa niroda Nama rupa niroda salatana niroda Salatana niroda bhasa niroda Bhasa niroda vedana niroda Vedana niroda dhanna niroda Dhanna niroda upadana niroda Upadana niroda bhava niroda bhava niroda jati niroda Jati niroda jaramaranam soka paradeva dukkha domana supayasa niroda janti Eva metasa kevalasa dukkha kandasa niroda bhoti Eto pachayva ramana pachaya adhipati pachayva nandara pachaya sanantara pachaya sahajata pachaya Anyamanya pachaya nisaya pachaya upanisaya pachaya kurejata pachaya Pachajata pachaya asevana pachaya gamma pachaya vipaka pachaya Ahara pachaya indriya pachaya jana pachaya magga pachaya Sampayata pachaya vipavita pachaya arti pachaya natti pachaya vigata pachaya avigata pachaya ti Etena satcha vajjena sattite hoti sambhala Etena satcha vajjena sabbarogo vinasatu Etena satcha vajjena hoti te jaya mangala Yamdundivitamava mangalancha yojamanako sakunasa sattu Pāpāgahar suvinākantam buddhānu bhāvena vināsamentu Yamdundivitamava mangalancha yojamanako sakunasa sattu Pāpāgahar suvinākantam dhammānu bhāvena vināsamentu Yamdundivitamava mangalancha yojamanako sakunasa sattu Pāpāgahar suvinākantam sanghānu bhāvena vināsamentu Sabbe buddhā balappattā paccekānañca yambalam Arahantanañca tejena rakkhaṁ gaṇḍhāmi sabbasu Sabbītiyo vivajantu sabba rogo vināsatu Māte bhāvantarāyo sukhī jīgāyuko bhava Bhavatu sabba mangalam rakkhantu sabba devatā Sabba buddhānu bhāvena sadā sutti bhavantu te Bhavatu sabba mangalam rakkhantu sabba devatā Sabba dhammānu bhāvena sadā sutti bhavantu te Bhavatu sabba mangalam rakkhantu sabba devatā Sabba sanghānu bhāvena sadā sutti bhavantu te Sādhu, sādhu, sādhu. So, today is the last topic. So we started by saying what is fate. Is it possible to change our fate? And how to change our fate, so-called fate. So today we have come to the last part of this. To what extent we can change our fate? We have already agreed that fate, so-called fate, whatever is told to us by a fortune teller or by anyone to make a prophecy to our life, then we know our life can change, but in what way, to what extent. So we have discussed how to change by changing perception, changing our way, by using the general law to change the way we regard life, Should we change the outer experiences based on the law of cause and effect? And having full faith in the power of Dhamma, we change. And then we also talk about, in the last talk, we talk about how we can change and make a big change by taking care of the last talk moment, and we have a good future life. So today we come to the last month. To what extent we can change our life, we can uplift our life. So we started to talk, today is the last one we want to do. When we started, we were going to explain how what is fate, how is fate this thing, we can change fate. 的修法，那你可以随便安排。还有另一条路，了脱生死，还有另一条路。这个是有些人发这种愿，还是提示佛。如果有更高的心愿，有些人发愿要成为圆满的一些智慧、慈悲、波罗蜜的佛陀，正等正觉的佛陀，是多么的殊胜！我们人，这个人一个众生的潜质、的生命，可以高度提升到哪个程度？到跟佛一样的程度。无限的智慧和慈悲，彻底的摆脱我们所有的一切的弱点，培育一切可能培育的所有的能力，所有的圆满，我们的生命，我们的命运可以将其提升。方法有了，只是需要时间和无限的这个付出的代价，我们愿意吗？这条路，重点是怎么走的 ？So we talk about uplifting our life, changing our faith. In the teaching of the Buddha, the human potential or the potential of beings can be greatly uplifted. It's almost no limit to it.Talks of perfecting our life, uplifting our life. There's almost no limit to it. I don't find it. Any teaching elsewhere which can tell us that our life can be uplifted that far. You see, in the teaching of the Buddha, it is not only teaching us to be reborn.To uplift ourselves in the deva level, sensual deva level. No, you can develop up to the Brahma, to be Brahma, the Rupa Brahma, material realm. Then you can even be the immaterial realm Brahma, which has no body, only the mind. And not only that, the Buddha tells us that we can actually, in the teaching of the Buddha, we can actually.Achieve liberation ourselves, realize divine ourselves, and be free from the rebirth into woeful realms. No more hell, no more rebirth, reborn into as animal, as ghosts, or the demons, asuras. No more lowly rebirth.By the achievement of Sotapattimagga, being a Sotapattimagga, the first stage of sainthood. When a person achieves the first stage of sainthood, he's free from all woeful realms, rebirth into woeful realms. Of course, Sotapattimagga still has anger, sensual lust, still have, still can live a merry life, but the assurance is there. In seven,lifetimes, you will be free from the realms of rebirth. And then this is second stage of sainthood, Sakkadagami. Then there's third stage of sainthood, Anagami, which is completely free from anger and fear and completely free from all sensual greed.And then the human potential can uplift further until a person is completely free from greed, anger, delusion, pride, jealousy, sort of top of all the weaknesses and become arahant. And once a person has attained arahantship, then he's no more rebirth in the next life. You will attain parinibbana when he passes away, that will be that's the end.Something beyond description, but permanent peace, happiness. When you realize the deathless, when you realize the unborn and the unconditioned, you some people may aspire, some people for some reason, they aspire to be a Vajika Buddha. There's also another level, also a Arhat, but at this higher level, they have got enlightened themselves, and then they'll be free from the realms of suffering, the realms of birth and death, the rebirth also. And further than that, if one has a great heart and wish to attain Buddhahood, to be achieve the same perfection as the Buddha himself, he can. So this is the potential that we can do if we want. It's our choice, which way we want. But this is just about the human potential can be greatly uplifted. Greatly uplifted. But different goal requires different price. You have to pay a price, you have to work for it. So now we shall come to saying, discussing the main aspect of it. So last week we talked about concentration. If you practice concentration, first jhana, second jhana, third jhana, fourth jhana, the absorption. This kind of a concentration, if you maintain it until that moment, then you can be born in the karma world. There are many types of concentrations, either you practice on loving kindness, compassion, appreciating joy, equanimity, or other types of concentration of kasinas, anapanasati, etc. And then if you want to be reborn in the arupa realm, immaterial realm, which has only the mind and no body, then you practice arupa jhana, the four types of arupa jhana. Concentration practice only. But this is the best result you can bring to us. But for Buddhists, we don't practice concentration practice for the mere sake of being reborn as a Brahma. Because even that, we can be impermanent. If we have not attained, like we have not seen the deathless, then future is still uncertain. But if for in order to be to have a kind of a lasting, permanent assurance to be free from suffering, then we need to develop this same goal. Insight, we need wisdom. We need to practice vipassana. This concentration practice, samatha. But that is not enough. To attain final liberation, we need to practice vipassana. So, for Buddhists, when we practice samatha, we practice concentration, it's only to be good, to have good foundation for our vipassana. Vipassana will be our main aim. But samatha is very useful. We use them to attain this concentration practice. It's important as a layout of foundation for our vipassana practice. One important thing for samatha, we can use from samatha practice, is the light of wisdom. When the practice concentration attain jhana, then naturally the mind, the jhana mind, which is which also has this quality of wisdom, that power of wisdom produces light, very powerful light. That powerful light becomes very helpful, very sharp to help us to penetrate ultimate reality in vipassana practice. 然后讲到这个我们有谈到之前也讲到这个定我们如果我们是修初禅的禅师禅四禅通过安观念或者是修习观我们会可以如果是维持到临终他会投身到这个梵天界而如果我们有这个 修行呢，不是为了我们修这个慈禅，这个三摩他，这个慈禅，不是。
Smallest unit that can arise and pass away, and in
in this color, you have different various elements that make up of it, like earth, water, fire, wind, element, like color, order, taste, and nutrition, at least like this. Now this karma, very subtle karma, there's an eye, transparency. This is all, you don't need to remember, just knowing. And then like when there's a man or woman, men they have a man, male sex materiality, and female have female sex materiality, something like that. And there's a life force that we call jivita. So it and all these kalapa, there are many types of kalapa. And there are four categories. Kalapa produced by karma, kalapa produced by consciousness, kalapa produced by decoration. And kalapa produced by food, nutrition. Nutrition is more correct, food is not so good. Nutrition, more precise is nutrition. So therefore, that's all kalapa. So all these things. But when you penetrate, and you see, this is only the, this is the reality. Ultimately, you penetrate deeply, what is the benefit? At that time, the compactness of grouping shattered completely. Because of this compactness of grouping, we are seeing things in the form of, we say this is body, this is man, woman, all this. This is our mind, in our mind, we have become compactness. Oh, my hand, my leg, my nails, my hair. But when you break down to that extent of ultimate reality, the compactness of grouping disappears. In at that time of experience, the mind is very sharp and very clear, penetrating the reality. Then, this compactness is removed. They no longer see this as man and woman. It's only ultimate reality. This is it. Secondly, while you are seeing all this ultimate reality, you are realizing you're passing away extremely fast. To the extent that you just cannot cross it. Cannot hold on to it, and you cannot catch any part of it and call it, clearly, this is my own, this is I, this is mine, this is myself. You can't. And at that time, literally, it produces a kind of purifying effect on the mind. This we call break down the compactness of continuity. Because of the continuity, you think, oh, this is I. I was hurt, I will be hurt in the future because of this attachment to this I. So much defilements arise in our mind, so much greed, so much anger, so much delusion, so much jealousy, stinginess arise in our mind. So we need to practice, when we practice, we pass on to that extent. And then you break down the second compactness. Then we further reduce our mind. Tendency to indulge in defilements, but not complete, not cut off yet. Still, defilements can arise every now and then. Then, when you further analyze all this materiality, like earth, yes, earth was a fire, all these color, taste, they have their functions, they have their characteristics. Their function, their manifestation, and the proximate cause that produce them. No need to go too deep, just have a general understanding of the sufficient. Because to go deep into it, you need to really go for a retreat that we have. It will take a long time to go deep into it. Just have a rough idea, don't get. For this tonight, I just want to give you a rough idea, and I want to tell you which to focus on. What are the emphasis of tonight's talk? So just a rough idea, just mention it. So when that happens, the compactness, we break down this kind of regarding function. Because of the, if you further break down this eye, the sense of eye, because all this everything, they make up all this group, ordinarily, and each ordinarily, they play a role. It has a role to play as a function, and has its manifestation characteristics, and approximate cost. So when that happens, the eye, the holding of the eye is further shattered. And further, they goes on to see the penetrate our reality about mentality. And then we'll further, more powerfully, remove our wrong understanding or wrong view, and then make us understand this ultimate truth further.
非常快速的生命的时候呢，它就破除了这个相续。
因为我们相信我们从小到大都是一个都一同一个我，所以我们才会有这个执着，过去人家伤过我，未来有人会伤害我，过去人家对我好，好我们是什么，只有这个爱恨交集种种的烦恼。可是当我们看到这个破除这个相续秘籍的时候呢，它完全生命的非常快速的时候，那么你发现到这个所谓的这个自我根本没有什么可以抓，没有什么东西你可以把它说这个是我，这个是我的自我，这是我的，你不能，所以那些烦恼就不容易生起，但是还是会生起，因为烦恼还没断，在这种阶段烦恼还没断。所以这些接下来你又再去观察，其实一个心，我们讲一个一个身体的这个，它每一个色绪地水火风，这些它有它的特性，它有它的功能，它有它显现的状态，它有它的助缘，它的因素聚义。所以等等的，现在你们不用背起来，你不用记，我只是这样讲过而已啊。因为这个还不是真正的重点，因为要了解这个，还要去修禅，还真正的去修。我们只是我这个在这方面，这个是很深的课题，我只是这样带过去，因为我要告诉你们重点何在。那么就这样子看下去的时候呢，那么其实那个那些所谓的邪见，我见的邪就开始粉碎了。开始破除了，开始破除的时候，破除了我见我执我慢的时候，当它在开始慢慢的减低的时候，我发现到你的心开始去净化，开始去清净起来，让它的烦恼就比较有力量。常常很多人我们听到大家说，哎，我的嗔心很强啊，或者是我的贪心很强，我不知道怎么掌控自己等等。对，我相信我们每个人都有这种经验，对，有些时候还是觉得困难的，但力量不够，因为。我们看到真实法的还没有足够的体验，当我们体验越深，我们的力量就越小，体验越深，力量就越小，这是方法。而且这样的时候，慢慢我们对这个社区设法的这个内外的设法，慢慢就破除这种种种的错见和执着，那个关系慢慢的慢慢被破除，慢慢被减少，但是不是断，还不是断，在这个阶段还不是断。而进一步的在修下去的时候，你不只是要对色法有这种洞察，你对心法也要有那个洞察，对心。那是你发现到一个心事，它一个心事它升起，升起生灭非常的快速，生灭心事生灭的比。设法生灭的更快，一个色聚一生一灭之间，心是生起，是起时，那么非常快速。当你看到那个心是生灭非常快速的时候，你破除了相续秘籍，你看到这在隐约和我跟你说，你在分析那个色聚、那个色聚、那个心事、那个心的时候，你发现到心有种种的心所组合而成，出的有呢。就是一般我们讲的，如果是你说五蕴的话，色受想行识，那个受想行识就是我们的明法，就是你可以讲的是精神状态。色法和明法的差别就是，色法它是一种现象，明法它有知道的能力，它取一个目标，它知道一个目标，这种我们是明法。那么那个心识不离开心的状态。有心事就有心的状态，这个心的状态我们叫心所，就好像水，水跟水的状态，对吗？那水有颜色，有味道，有它的那个有波浪还是没波浪等等，那些都是水的状态。那心事也是，心事有心事的状态，比如说感受啊、知觉，那些意志啊，那个心思。那个一心心心不动摇，那个作意，这些全都是心的状态，正念啊，信心啊，这些都是心的状态，有圣洁，有决心、决意，那个力量那也是心的状态，种种，善有不善的有啊，贪啊，嗔啊，或者是痴啊、妒忌啊，
只知道这个世俗义的话，他不能够。可是
他很明白一种矛盾，很多东西他不能理解，你说无我，谁在轮回？他不能理解。可是当一个人他开始了解，得到这个真实法跟这个看法的平衡的了解的时候，也发现到他可以很好、很平常的在世间生活，而且呢，同时比较容易克服自己的贪嗔痴。至少在他安住在真实法的当儿，看到那种快速生灭、无常不惑的当儿，烦恼不容易升起。 然后，所以我们会找个老人，they don't need the benefit of mentality. So, when a person is using the light of wisdom based on penetration of the materiality, it goes on to penetrate the mind. It's arising in passing away at such a high speed. When one galapa arises and passes away one time, then the consciousness of our mind arises and passes away 17 times. And then this consciousness, this mind, it doesn't arise alone, it arises together with mental states, associated mental states, such as feeling, perception, and thought and thought, etc. And then wholesome states are a lot, like moral shame, moral fear, and then wholesome state of wisdom, lightness of mind, tranquility of mind, and pliancy, lightness, and then a lot of mental states, the uprightness of the mind, and then compassion, and then equanimity, one point, and that's a lot of mental states, wholesome and unwholesome, and the neutral type also. And when a person sees like that, the compactness of the grouping is destroyed. What we call this soul, we always have this idea of soul. But when you see like that, it is only made up of mental states indeed. The difference between consciousness and mental state is just a difference between water and the states of water. You look at the water, it can be moving, stagnant, clear, unclear, having taste, good taste and bad taste, etc. See, but this states of water cannot, it's always associated with the water. And the states of the mind and is always associated with the consciousness. So in this way. And then we see consciousness arise and pass extremely fast. The compactness of continuity is broken. And you see every aspect of this ordinary reality, these mental states and this consciousness, they have their characteristics, their functions, their manifestation, and their proximity cause also. Well, this one you need to go deep into understanding. This is a profound subject. I just mentioned it after what are the important things to go for. It is taught. So I just mentioned it simply. So when the person understands like that, then you'll realize this is actually nothing permanent. It's all impermanent. And it's oppressive. It is unsatisfactory because it's oppressive. And when you rise and pass extremely quickly, and then there's nothing to hold on to. There's no permanent entity. There's no self. But still, at that time, the person may feel, I have this understanding, this is the I that experiences this. He may feel a sense of superiority and self. Then this practice of vipassana, you train the yogi to see even the wisdom that arises to see this anicca dukkha anatta. Even this wisdom itself, this jnana, is arising and passing away. It's also impermanent suffering, unsatisfactory and non-self. And then when that realization happened through the practice, we call it arupasataka practice in the vipassana, in the part of the vipassana training, then this we call aranapanagana is a compactness of aramana. I don't know how to translate it. So, it's further broken. It basically means even the I, you think there's I that experiences it, even the experiencer, even the wisdom is arising and passing away. It's also impermanent suffering and non-self. And when that happens, the person starts to understand the difference between conventional truth and ultimate truth. Conceptual world, conceptual truth, and ultimate reality. If a person person doesn't vanish is by experience. The person by book knowledge is always one self, no self. So I can kill anybody. There's no one to be killed. There's no one who's killing. Then he is totally chaotic and devil. But when a person really penetrated by experience, this conflict will not happen. At the same time, while he understands ultimate reality, that ultimate reality's understanding can help him to reduce the chances of having defilements. Not cut, yeah, not approaching yet, not at this stage. But the chances of having defilements are much less. At least when you realize impermanent suffering runs out, at the moment of penetrating impermanent suffering runs out, it's very unlikely for defilements to arise. Especially, even at the beginning stage, it is unlikely. But if it's at a deeper stage, profound stage, completely no defilements can possibly arise. Okay. So that helps. Helps a person to live. Without defilements, the mind is much happier. It's having more endurance to pain, to challenge that. That's in life. At the same time, you also understand conventional level. That doesn't make you fail to recognize this is a man, this is a woman, you know, and a certain propriety in regards to every situation, to parents, to father, mother. You know, it doesn't go to make a person lose his respect to parents, to elder people, to wise men. No, that will not happen. In fact, by more understanding of ultimate truth, a person's mind naturally slowly get purified. And when we purify, he only be able to conduct himself much better in conventional world. Because the mind gets pure. All he needs to do is he doesn't go and try to feed, use conceptual, try to think, or use the mind, use the intelligence to extrapolate the knowledge. He should penetrate more by experience. Okay. Then we go further. Further into dependent origination. The second level of wisdom will arise when we practice. At first, the initial stage of impermanent suffering, that's only superficial. Not deep enough. At first, it's more like preparing and laying the ground for real, the deeper vipassana. That stage of seeing the what is materiality, what's materiality, that's only like we call laying down the vipassana movie, you know, the grounds for vipassana. But at the same time, at that time already you see impermanent suffering oneself. But that's not the main thing yet at that stage. It's more like identifying what are materialities and what are mentalities. Okay. Then we come to this stage we call dependent origination. You see past and present and future. How lives evolve from one life, what are the causes to produce another life? What are the causes produce and the past causes produce present effect, the present causes produce future effect. Okay? Past causes usually what produce a taking on a river birth, we call Abhijatana Varana Sankara Kam, ignorance, craving is excessive craving, and then Sankara formations, then karma. In this aspect, the formation is a broader meaning. Just briefly want to mention this. Okay, we have limited time. So, these are the five causes, past five causes, present effect, that we get this life, and this present that we get before life, is present, five causes to produce future life, future effect. So, in this way, and what are the benefits of penetrating this? It helps us to understand rebirth. It helps us to understand cause and effect. It helps us to understand that while the penetrating is actually, at the same time, you also see there's not a self is there. Based on conditions, something happens. And when the condition disappears, it's no more there. That phenomena is no more. Because of five past causes, we get this life, this materiality and mentality. And also, life, when life goes on, further causes add in, present causes add in to sustain this life. And when the causes disappear, no more, and we die, and new When we see that, there's only conditioning we need. Again, you will see anything substantial.
So the long view
can further diminish. Then the doubt, is that the past time, is that future, is that cause and effect? Then that doubt is a thing. When that doubt is a thing, you see how wonderful it is. If only the world, more and more people penetrate this truth of dependent origination by seeing more, further understand about cause and effect and rebirth, then you find the world's problem, the world will have peace. Because racism, people think, oh, I'm Chinese, I'm Indian, I'm white, I'm black. All this, so much problem happened because of this attachment to this wrong view. See, the world will suffer because of these wrong views. If only they know that, it's only for a short time. You cannot really call yourself Chinese, you temporarily call yourself Chinese, or Indians, or whites, or black. But ultimately, it's only ultimately a reality. It's the first stage of a realization of a reality already helping to remove the understanding. And then you know that you can be reborn, not only as a human being, you can be reborn as a demon, as a brahman, and also animals, animals. So what is this thing that attached to call a race? You see people fight so much. The Taoists and the Sinhalese fight so much. And it's true, so much. And then people from different religions they fight. Because you don't really understand rebirth and cause and effect. If they understand cause and effect, you will know now I shouldn't plant no more. New causes, wrong causes, which can produce future suffering. I will stop. I don't want to create new causes of suffering. If you really understand the no cause and effect, not really believe the no cause and effect, then you have a strong motivation to do the good things. Not because someone does, not because some brain, something brainwashes. No. It's not through brainwash we want to do good. Because you do good, because this is in accordance with the truth, in accordance with the reality, you do good. So when you understand that, when people understand that, naturally, a lot of problems, internal problems of a man or a woman, of a people, of a village, of a town, of a country, of the world, will be easily done away with. So this is the benefit. When we see truth, we know it's just like you see it when with the light, you see truth. You see a cliff, no one will choose to follow unless the person wants to commit suicide. But if the person really understands what will happen after suicide, no one will jump. No one will jump down from the cliff. You know it's more horrible, the world after suicide is more horrible. And you will not commit suicide. So things like that. So this is really penetrating reality. And the truth speaks for itself. The truth tells us much truth. Not someone tells us. No longer at that time, you no longer need the Buddha to tell us, oh, you should do this. You know, this is only for our own good only. We don't need to be forced to do good. Each of you, you know, we want to do good. If someone at that stage steals occasionally steal it, they say, this is because of habitual tendencies. Because the found is not operated yet. But at least the faith is there. You know, even if you have a room for bad things, you know it's no good for you. Because you know that cause and effect is the law of cause and effect. So this understanding is so useful. It gives us natural strength to uplift our life. It teaches a way to uplift our life. We start to know what are the causes which will benefit us. What are the causes? You know, whatever wholesome causes you create, you only produce good results. Bad causes only produce bad results. You never make any mistakes. But superficially, apparently, yes, it may happen. Sometimes you try to help people and then people blame you for helping. It can happen this way. But the intention of trying to help people, the pure motivation, the good heart, the good karma, always will be good results sometime later. If people regard us badly, repay, forbid do bad to us because we regard them well and they do bad to us. That is not because of our kindness. It's because of some other causes. When we can understand like that, then the faith, the knowledge, the confidence of doing good get established. So when that happens, we have natural force, nature of the wisdom will try to prepare us what to do. We have motivation, the force that make us continue to move towards the light. And when that happens, evolution comes much faster, so much faster. 所以精神呢，就是当我们了解名色法的时候，是那个时候也有一些无常苦果的体验。可是那个时候的无常苦果体验还不是主要的，因为过后它主要是在定下那个基础，给我们修习观察。那个只是病是什么是色法，什么是名法，什么是这些这个物质，什么是那个精神状态。 进一步的，我们进一步的，我们要看三世因缘，这个缘起是过去的什么因导致现在的果，现在的因导致未来的果。那么这个缘起呢，就这个过去的因，无明爱取行业，无明是无知，我们的痴心，不了解真相。那么这个贪爱呢，是一种执着。 取是很强的执着，还是在重复巩固的。啊，行，行，行，是我们呢在做的时候的那个心，是在这方面，这个行是那个造业行。那么那个业是那个行，它生灭过后，它留下的能量和细微的能量，那个我们叫做业。好，但是我们不要在这方面深入，你只要知道有这个概念就好。 更重要的是，其他后面，因为这个东西要详细，要花费时间，要一些详细的详细需要一些时间。那么这个过去的五种因导致我们现在投生男人、女人，还是什么投生到哪里？天人还是什么？那么过去的因投生导致今世的生命，那这一世的因五种因导致来世的生命，就是这样子，这个因缘投生，过去、现在、未来，在这样子看的时候呢？ 这就是这个过程里面，你会了解到因果真实不虚。如果在临终的时候，他成熟的是善业，你肯定投生到善的地方；如果临终的时候成熟的是恶业，你肯定投生到不好的地方去。所以这个就是，当你这样子看到的时候，哎，就是这个是真的是真相，就是如此。然后那个时候对因果上有三宝，有个报的信息去巩固，慢慢去巩固，当然可以看得更加仔细。这个因缘。
只是利益相，可以看得更加的仔细，可以更仔细的看到是什么因导致什么，今天你的遭遇什么，这其实随着能力、修行的能力再加强，它可以看得更仔细。我们简单来讲，它就是给你那个巩固的这个因果的智慧。同时，你看这个本来就是有轮回，但是这个轮回过程中，你不会华人只是轮回成华人，或者是印度人只是轮回成印度人，不会是如此。 其实我们未必只是沦为做人，有些时候成天神，成梵天神，或者是不好的，就堕落到苦界去、地狱里面去，都有的。所以当你这样子看到的时候，你就心里的那种很多的错觉就找回来，对自我的执着，以为自己执着自己的民族主义，其实也没有需要。什么我是什么国家的人，也没有什么需要。 男人、女人的执着也没有什么需要。男人可以投生做女人，女人可以投生做男人。人可以投生做畜生，可以投生天使，天使可以投生做人，很畜生。所以当你现在看的时候，还有什么民族主义要执着呢？你今天你看到在西兰，现在战争刚刚结束，他们西兰人跟这个大地的人跟那种争执和执着，那种种族斗争，是多么的可怕！ 死了那么多的人，只要人们真正是你说他们有信仰，可是信仰能力不够。如果他们真正看到轮回，了知轮回，了知就是这样子的现象的时候，他们自然就不会这样子。
Because without samadhi, vipassana training, So our life is made of it. And if we choose to change our fate or with our life to a great extent, then this will be the important thing to consider. Samatha and vipassana, especially vipassana training. So even Chaitanya,
真的是用这一生你就要了生脱死的话，那你真的要看看究竟是明法界。
身体释放，那么它也是才有那个力量，你智慧之光吸取完成，才有那种力量。像是，可是好的，你其实多看点无常，我说是好的，只是表现你在那个阶段。那么你自己止禅呢？不，通常来修，我们也有一些学生，他们是修四大不对观，可是当他修到见行定的时候呢，其实可以把它转一转。如果能够学到见行定，已经开发出智慧之光的时候呢，其实转一转，它蛮容易就可以入出禅的禅三禅四禅。比较难，人家想想哇，这个很简单，非常非常非常难。其实就是在这次的修行人之中，你就发现到，有些还是蛮好多，就是你们自己太平的，也并不真的是那么难。他们都是在家学习，有些时候是你没试，你试了你就你可能会才有了解，但是有些人用比较久。可是如果那个人过了运不够的话，他只是看那个初显的阶段，在初显的方式看我怎么服务，有些时候你是看了好多好多年，也一样没有办法表现妥协。相反的，如果你好好的给自己打好基础，培养定，可能用几年来培养定，可是真正修习观的时候呢，可以很快，可以很快，很快速，很有力量。比较难是初禅，大多数人都是卡在比较慢的是初禅。可是当他经过一番经历，他过了那个时候，我该断绝的时候，那是他的努力就有效率了，他不再一直打妄念。那个时候呢，他可以一到了初禅，你看大多数人到了初禅，初禅上二禅，其实是蛮快的；二禅上了四禅蛮快，四禅都上到了，就形成几个方法，非常非常一个可以学到。所以比较难是初期的那个阶段。当然你说啊，我现在生活上不要出意外，克服生活上的贪嗔痴，那么做一些无常苦我的心思，都是有好处的。有些时候我都会教他们，到底什么在障碍上面。你要看看你的念头来，它灭了，其实你就不微心苦，哎，但是我的念头你放掉，很容易放掉它，还是有好处的。我不能说它没好处，我只是说看你的目标在哪里。如果你真的很肯去要得到那么高、那么殊胜的那个法的结果的话呢，那其实你有一个高的结果是不需要付出大大的代价，不需要代价的。所以看你付出什么代价。现在人都是想 shortcut， 可是我们相信的是把老师是用过的，所以这样子。So， 什么还有问题？So， I'll try some questions. She asked， we have limited time as a lay person. So，as a lay person, we have limited so much to do, so we may not have enough time to practice samatha vipassana, a strong method. So can we just practice vipassana? Actually, we can. The actual way, according to Vishnumaka, if you do the pure vipassana, you go by the four elements practice, you can practice up to actually hours of people training.Practice up to Upachara Samadhi, excess concentration. At that time, if there's brilliant light, it also arise. Not only jhana produced light of wisdom, even excess concentration produced light of wisdom. And then, of course, these four elements practice, it is technically classified under Samatha also. So you have to go through a Samatha. But it doesn't produce a jhana. This type of practice doesn't produce jhana. So because of that, sometimes we say this is pure vipassana way.Right, because it doesn't produce jhana, we also call it pure vipassana. Right, it can be classified under samatha, because it is Vishuddhimagga is classified under samatha. So this practice where you get a brilliant light, you can also analyze. You can also practice this ultimate reality. Can. But it's a bit sometimes tired because the concentration is trying to so good. But usually once a person reaches excess concentration, when the brilliant light arrives,Usually, you prefer to switch them to other samatha object to get jhana because it's not too difficult anymore. Once a person gets very strong excess concentration, it's just not in the past sometimes days to switch and can get jhana. Usually, the difficulty is only for most people, it's first jhana only. Once you experience, once you get first jhana, then from first jhana to fourth jhana, something only a few days you can reach up to fourth jhana. And once you have a fourth jhana, every other meditation subject become easy. You can quickly complete 10 asanas and up to arupajana, up to neither perception nor non-perception. Not too difficult. So the difficulty is first jhana, because if when a person has first jhana, his effort becomes so much efficient because of the suppression of five hindrances. Before first jhana, you have all the five hindrances disturbing you. So because that's why it becomes very difficult. But there's always a price to pay. You see, if you don't have good concentration, you want to see anicca dukkha anatta, you don't have the light of wisdom, you want to see anicca dukkha anatta. But it takes a long time. You, how deep can you penetrate? You know, it's very difficult to penetrate very deep. So some people even get hang on in seeing anicca dukkha anatta for many, many years. You know? It gets stuck. See? Still gets stuck. But if you lay down the foundation, you didn't light of wisdom, you didn't jhana or whatever, much faster. So in our practitioners, some people practice up to excess concentration, they also finish, they can finish the course, finish the whole training, possible. But these people, now from experience, it seems that it's much, much slower. Those who don't want to go to jhana, they practice purely, they actually take longer time to do vipassana, they take much longer time. So if a person gets excess concentration, we just, from experience, we prefer to switch people straight to jhana, second jhana, third jhana, fourth jhana, and do a lot of kasina. In fact, it's better to let them do more kasinas practice, the other type of concentration, samatha practice. More they do, the better. They can finish one kasina in one day. After that, they can finish one kasina in one day or 2 days, and another kasina, and another kasina. So within the short time, you master so many things. You look at the chart, you have so much to do, it seems so difficult. One already difficult. Actually, the real difficulty is only the first one. The first entrance. Once you get into the entrance, the rest is just doing it. It's just a changing object. Concentration is still concentration. Fourth jhana concentration is still fourth jhana concentration. So you see, this is how even now you find that your Taiping people, the participants, those people that you're familiar with, so quite a number of them, they are getting up to very high level already, they get good concentration. So they are also lay people, you see. It's not impossible, it's possible. Really, you can try it out. But at the same time, I don't really discourage contemplation of anicca dukkha anatta at any level. At any level of contemplation of anicca dukkha anatta is also helpful. So sometimes when our students, they have a wandering thought so much, you just say, oh, you see the cessation, oh, you see, the moment they are aware of wandering thought, they are wandering thought cease. So don't need to hang on. So sometimes it might be easier to overcome the defilements. So it is also good. We are not saying that it is bad. But we are just saying that depends on what is your aim. If you only want daily purification, that's very good. But if your aim is very high, you have to pay a high price for it. If your aim is not to be liberated, you want to be free from samsara, then pay a high price. If no one, then any practice is good. You just verify your mind, metta, karma, mudita, whatever. Even up to jhana level, daily practice of ordinary learning kindness, it helps you to change your life so much. Not only jhana change your life, but the living practice of learning kindness change your life. So that way, depends. So if you have a high aim and high hope, then it is good to practice exactly according to ancient texts. And then that will lead you to a long way. But good, not much for me. So anything?
Thank you, Bhante, for your wonderful Dhamma on faith. I just have a question. During the third session, we touched on confession and cessation of bad karmic pattern. My question is, does the natural law of cause and effect applies to all, irregardless of religion? As we know, in Christian gospel, you know, if one accepts Jesus Christ, confess the sins and repent, they all go to heaven, they're saved. So, in this case, I always have doubts on this because if one commits a terrible crime, they still go to heaven in this case, according to the gospel. So, what is the view in a Buddhist perspective on this?
Very good. Actually, that's a Christian view. If you confess, you still go to heaven. But that's not a Buddhist view. In our Dharma, everything, you know, if you have done something bad, confess only, you stop the bad generally. You know, what you have done, you have done, the karma is done. You know, if you can stop the pattern from continuing to kill people, then that will stop a lot of problem. At least the evil can stop, the cycle stops. Then that's how confession really helps. So often people suffer a lot, unnecessarily, you know. They have a little bad karma, but the bad karma right, they create more bad karma when the bad karma is right away. Because of that, the cycle move on. A lot of suffering. If you need compassion, you just think, oh, this I know, this is wrong, I don't continue anymore. You know? Then the pattern can broken. You see, the tendency of trying to do the bad things, saying bad things, it stops. So because of that, then that karma still better. But we don't deny that the person who killed some people may still go to heaven. Depends. Because if he has done tremendous good, you know, as we say, there are a lot of, then maybe the last of moment, the good things arrive. But still, this bad karma of killing people will cause some suffering. If a person is born as a human being, okay, maybe a shorter life. Because last of moment is born, okay, yes, to get a human life, they escape. But that killing karma can cause a person to be deformed. Things like that. You know, we obstruct their good karma. So things like that. So cause and effect always works. But it works in various ways. It may not work in the as a determining the reverse, but it works in obstructing good karma. It can happen. So in this way, we don't deny that there are cause and effect. It's always cause and effect. The only thing is confession helps, but we must know the limit. We are not trying to praise, uphold confession beyond the limit. Say that you can do anything and then you confess and go to heaven and nothing will happen. Then you can always confess at the last day before you die. Then so you can just continue and do and join all the bad and kill people and do all the horrible things. And then last day you can confess, I accept Jesus Christ and go to heaven. It cannot happen that way, isn't it? That is not competition. That's not competition. So we just need compassion to determine to come out from the bad cycle. But also we can reduce suffering by, if we know we have done something bad, we quickly do a lot of giving, do a lot of dana, sila, power. We instill a lot of very strengthen our mind power. Then we will be more able to sustain, maybe to absorb the result of the recovery. Thank you. Still will happen. Some people may suffer sickness, but they don't get a good doctor. Some people may suffer sickness, they get a good doctor. Then you make a difference, you know. So when people have a nurse to make a good doctor, get good medical service, then the person may escape that. Another person having the same outcome, but you know, so if he doesn't have good marriage to support him, and the woman he rushed to the hospital, the doctor all the whole way, it just happened to be so bad, and then he died. So things like that, so we can do a lot of wholesome deeds to support us. Hopefully, when that karma ripens, then at least our whole karma is good enough, strong enough to absorb it. Like a big ship, you know, you can take a whole aeroplane there. But if there's no ship there, even if they put a small pebble, they drop into the sea, they sink to the deepest. You know? So it's something like that.
Thank you.
Another question is, in the Christian faith, it says, we chant. If a person, no matter how big or small, if they believe in Jesus, and then accept Jesus, then if they chant, they will be able to get the key. 那么我说这是基督教。
佛像不是像真像的。我佛像里面是说因果的，还是有因果的，只是说我们的那个你忏悔的，你决心这个是错的，我不要再做的，那么那个循环就停止了。如果我们没有忏悔，我们还是倾向那个形象，还继续在那里演变，还要再去找，还要去找。可是我们忏悔了，那个效果就，那个一直让我们继续循环的那种效果，那种模式，业的模式就可以因为我们的忏悔而破除。所以这样子的话，就少了很多苦痛。很多时候，一个人他造了恶，他就，比如说一个人他是有自杀的话，他以后在众生，他就一直在想着自杀，更惨。啊，一直有那个自杀的念头，一直想着自杀的。有些人，那如果他过去是自杀过的话，然后即使是下了地狱出来的话，还是一直想着自杀，所以就是苦就会再继续找苦因，苦就找苦因。可是如果是他有那个忏悔，他知道是错的，我不要犯，那么他慢慢就从那个循环里面走出来，这样子的。要不然的话，如果是忏悔是关人的话，那我们可以等，我要做坏事就做坏事，做我做到了，然后最后天临死之前讲啊，我忏悔，我相信主，我相信耶稣，那是得跳上天，那不是很划算，很面向划算的事。不管如何，我们也没有说杀人一定会上不了天，不一定，看哪一个。如果你的善业很强很强，过去就算你杀人，可是现在善业很强很强，像那么如果是临终的一个善业起来，你可能投身到好的地方去开始做人，可是那恶业还在，杀人的恶业可能让他短命，投身的时候短命啊，或者是残血啊之类的，还是有的，所以业还是真实不虚的，还是有的。所以当我们在了解的时候，我们就会知道我实在是真实不虚，忏悔只是一个工具来帮助我们而已，但是它没有绝对的力量，它不是绝对的法。所以我们还是需要让师生去净化，去修。那当然像阿弥陀佛，他杀了九百九十九个人，可是因为他是阿罗汉道，然后这个阿罗汉道果他再也不会投生，所以也什么都不需要，他自然就再也不会用来世。所以其实杀过人，可是他们也是有在他那一世的时候，还是给人家丢石头，丢头破血流。可是呢，他不会再让他投生，还是在无限里面去。所以这就是法的力量。所以呢，就说两个人呢，或者把我明白了，因为有一条很难很难很难，不是。By causing a strong release in the past, a strong power of it, and it attained Arahant Dhamma, and kind of all the farms, no longer will be reborn in, no longer will be reborn in any way. So all the bad karma has no chance to ripen. But yes, the killing karma still ripen at that time. Yeah, the event will be the balance if the truth is not here. He thinks like that. But at least he would produce bad people, would be reborn in hell. So there's a power of Dhamma. If we practice more Dhamma, then we can really protect our life. Because everyone at one time or another must have done something bad. Those days when we were young, sometimes we look at hands, we just kill. Mosquito, we just kill. So I'm sure everyone has some kind of bad karma like this. Killing karma, lying karma, etc. So when we do a lot of good, then we can protect ourselves.因为我们过去五个人造些恶，所以如果我们积多的善，我们能够用善心来保护自己。那么其他不说了，那么以后就你们一起的，那你给我来带个毛 stories 和理论。你觉得还可以讲，把我讲我啊，就是考的 aspect of how you can evolve our life and change our life, and the most important aspect.If you have time, then it's always a very interesting thing. Especially the reverse of it. How, actually, in the book, you learn a lot of things. A lot of things about yourself, about truth. You know how by giving freedom to others, you get freedom. How by just following the wise, you can change your life so much.
So we shall have you able to